a few people have have pointed out that Mr. Ben Olsen was not wearing a belt in his and it was a fashion faux pas.
Oh, he looked terrible. That tie was gross.
Fuck belts.
I'll be right back.
That is where I stand on that. So yeah, take that shit.
Welcome to the show. Rudy's here.
Hello.
Nick's here.
Oh, yeah.
Sara allegedly will be here later. And that's it. That's all you guys. All right. We've been gone for a hot minute. We had a show fall into the recording abyss last week. And we're back. We're going to touch on the Rapids game first. Chicago Fire played Colorado Rapids Wednesday, May 17th. Fire 1-3-2-0. Your scoring summary is as follows. In the 15th, Nemanja Nikolic, assisted by Brandon Vincent. In the 57th, David Akam, assisted by Michael Dele and Matt Holster. 74th, Nemanja Nikolic, assisted by Michael Dele. Yellow card for Michael Azira in the 62nd. All right. What'd you think of this one? Nick, let's start with you.
Well, this was a pretty comprehensive, commanding win. Very strong at home, of course, as you would hope. I thought that Colorado didn't really offer too much going forward to test our back line. But when we had the ball, it looked like we were really in control of this game. When the first goal went in, I think that this was like one of the first times in a while that I felt like comfortable and safe when we had a lead. So top to bottom, front to back, strong performance, good result, just putting a team down and piling on the goals. That's something that we really haven't seen in a while. So this is a welcome return to the Fire of old.
Well stated. Rudy.
Man, that was a good game. I thought we dominated the whole game. It was after the first goal went in, it was really, really, really hard to see us lose at that point. I think Matt Polster at right back now has turned into the solution. He looks like he's very comfortable in that position. He can get back in time and make a run as well. I think that was a good test just to make sure that was happening. No Nico, no party, because he's scoring like a madman, especially that week alone. He had scored, what, total of, what, four goals or six goals? What was it? Or, no, four goals or five goals?
Five.
Whatever. Five, yeah, okay. Yeah. Whatever, math's not good. So, total domination, I thought. Or at least enough domination to be comfortable and not just think, oh man, we could have fucked it up this time. We also seen Lamson have a steady game in the back, not much action towards him, but there were no mistakes on his end when he did have to touch the ball, like that once or twice he had to. Just lovely, lovely to see.
Yeah, I mean, I'd like to just, you know, we didn't do a show after the Seattle game, but Drew Connor had a terrific game against Seattle at right back. And I think right back is taken care of. I'm good. Polster is your starter. Drew's your backup. I'm good. Your left back is good, right? It's Vincent and Duty. Perfect. Mm-hmm. We can we could put a man on the moon, is what I'm saying. Okay.
I think I get what you're saying.
I think our great nightmare is hopefully over.
I think we can dust off the old launcher.
I think there's a spot in the second Star Club waiting just for him.
Okay, so one stat really jumped out at me. I was really only able to watch the extended highlights of this game. One stat really jumped out at me, and that was the fact that we held 57.3% of the possession.
Yep.
That's a lot. 85% passing accuracy. That's very good. We also like pass the ball a lot. Like 547 completed passes. This is a lot of passes. When this team plays well, we hold the ball. This is not a counterattacking team. Those days are gone. This is over. Not that it can't be done, but it's not the identity of the team anymore.
Thank goodness.
Yeah, I agree. I really enjoyed what I saw. I was up trying to watch this game from Europe, and I was unable to get a steady feed going. But I did see Nico's first goal, and he does everything right, and it's great. It's great times. What I saw that early morning was great. And then when I watched the extended highlights, I was like, oh, this looks like it was a fun game. I was very happy. So let's move on. Versus the old DC United. A team I have a noted soft spot for. Except when they play the Fire. Well, Fire win. 1-0. On the road.
Holy shit.
Woo!
Yep, David Akam getting the lone goal in the 52nd minute, assisted by who? Mr. Lewis Solignac. It's a great pass from Solignac to spring him. Disciplinary summary, Marcelo Sarvis, yellow. Lamar Nagel, yellow. And Bastian Schweinsteiger gets a yellow for a description of dangerous play.
Which is the biggest bullshit ever.
Weakest dangerous play I've ever seen in my life. So I was looking at the stats on this game. And we had 58.1% of the possession on the road.
Jesus.
What I saw was a dominating performance, Rudy. And you were there live, so give us the breakdown. How was the live? How was it in person? How'd you feel watching that game? And
big crowd. Well, for RFK, it was a big crowd. There were a lot of Germany jerseys and Bayern Munich jerseys. So yeah, that's
I love the fake Germans. Love them.
That gives you an idea of how that crowd was. In person, it felt there were a couple of brief moments of unease where it seemed like they were going to start attacking, especially towards the end when there were a couple of stupid fouls from Matt Pulser and a couple other people who just, you know. Yeah, there were a couple of moments of unease, but after that, it was like we knew we had control of the game. If it weren't for Bill Hamid, this game should have been 5-0, 6-0, easy. He was standing on his head. And watching Pano screech Peter Vermees like on the sidelines most of the game was fucking awesome. He's got something in him. And also watching Ben Olsen screech for all the wrong reasons. Just as good. Just as good. I just, you know, it's the first road win I've seen in 3 years. So to me, this is fucking awesome.
The monkey's off your back, Gomez.
Seriously. Only Antoine and John Petty have seen a more recent victory, I believe.
Wow.
Yeah, that was in Montreal.
Oh, wow. Man. Must feel good.
Amazing.
I thought Hilarious Grajeda had a terrible game as referee. Yes, he did. I thought he was hilariously bad. The call that just epitomized the entire night was the foul he calls on Schweinsteiger, where Basti just curls over, like, fetal positions the ball because he didn't touch the man. The guy just fell down and he happened to be jumping, like, waiting for the ball. He didn't even touch him. The dude just was like, whoop. And Gray is like, no, fuck you. That's a foul. I was just like, you gotta be kidding me. You didn't even touch him. And I honestly think Gray is generally a pretty good ref, but whew, this is a bit of a howler of a game for him. Thankfully, he didn't. His linesmen were fucking spot on in this game all night long. They were all really good. Nick, why don't we just? What are your thoughts on this one?
Yeah, another complete performance. This one, I felt like had the team really put it into high gear. But the Fire did have the better of the chances, clearly the better of the possession. DC didn't get a shot on goal until after the 80th minute. So, I mean, just a good professional performance on the road. We talked about Matt Polster at right back. I agree. This is working out much better than I thought it would. So I feel totally cool with him there. And I don't know. I do think that right now both DC and Colorado are disastrously bad. But again, we did what we had to do against bad teams. And that's bury them at home and win on the road. And these are the kind of performances that we have to get from them if we really want to be serious about the playoffs. So, job well done, and let's go on to the next one.
Yeah, in complete agreement. I know people, you know, are kind of pointing at, you know, sort of the weakness of these teams, but these are games that we've perennially fucked up for the past 5 years.
Yeah.
And, You got to do this. You got to take – there's 6 points. You got to take them. And we beat Seattle as well, a team that people regard more than they should. We beat them. And that's been a team we've had difficulty beating as well. So the three wins we strung together are important wins. And, you know, 9 points is 9 points. You know, like – We're doing quite well for ourselves. If we go to the old standings as we currently sit, second place in the East.
Wow. And where are we in the Brimstone or in the supporter shield?
Just hang tight. We have 21 points. We're averaging 1.75 points per game, which is second in the East. By the way, that 1.75 points per game would be good enough for second in the West as well. As things stand right now, the East is the stronger conference. The Supporters Shield standings, Rudy, as you asked, we sit third. Yep.
I can't believe that we're actually talking about the Supporter Shield right now.
Well, we have to. I know.
It's just been that long since we've had a serious discussion about it.
We're 12 games into the season. It's fair to discuss. It's not out of bounds. Where our home form is we're 5-0-1 at home, which is Supporter Shield pace. We are 1-3-2 away, which is not bad, you really need a point per game on the road. It's kind of where I kind of ballpark it. Point per game on the road is where you want to be. We're a little bit off that pace, but not bad. And Sporting KC and Toronto have played more games than us. Ooh, one game each. Who sit ahead of us in the old Supporter Shield race. I know it's a little early, or not. It's, you know, we have to discuss it, and it's not really a goal for this season. But I'd like it to be a goal, so I'm just gonna monitor this as the year goes by. So we've had the start we needed to have. We've done what we've needed to do. We're over 20 points after 12 games.
Yeah, Gregg,
that's incredible.
Your guide was what, 15 points for 15 each and 10 games? Yeah.
Yep. 15 and 10.
Seattle was game 10, and after game 10, we had 15 points. 15. Yep.
Yeah, that's, to me, the hump. 15 every 10 games is playoff, is definite playoffs, possible Shield contention, but the first 10 games are crucial. As we know, it's really hard to dig yourself out of a hole, and right now, you look at the teams trying to dig themselves out of that hole. You're looking at DC United, Montreal, Atlanta. You know, Atlanta has 15 points in 11 games, so it's not that big of a hole, but like, they were only at 12 in 10, which is okay. You can come back from that. Or you could be even worse. You could be Colorado, you could be RSL. You know, Minnesota's in that hole. Sounders are in that hole. I mean, these are all teams that are going to struggle for the rest of the year. The West is going to be interesting to watch just because it looks like it could be 5, 6, 7 could be very weak. And there could be points there. But, you know, good start. Good start for us in the East. And everybody deserves to feel good about this. I don't want to see any fucking snark on the internet, is what I'm saying. all right. Anything else you want to say about either of those matches, gentlemen?
No, I'm good.
Keep Polster at right back, please.
I would think that that is a... That was partially the plan all season, coming into the season and before Matt got hurt.
Also, one more thing, at least on my part. So, who's as excited as we were to see the Armenian Ibra?
Oh, God.
Yeah.
The Arshakian has been awakened from cryogenic freezing. God. I was happy to see him. I'm glad to see he's okay, that he's healthy.
He's alive.
He does exist. We do need a second striker. It's undeniable. If there is a weakness in this side right now, it is, you know, if Nico goes down, God forbid, we're Lewis Soloniak starting up top, and that is bad times. Bad times.
Well, okay. I'm down for Joey Calistri coming back and saving the day.
Yeah, you probably have to bring Joey back.
He is tearing up USL right now pretty good.
No, he's playing good right now. All credit to Joey. I'm just saying, it's not good. It's not good. So I'd still like to see, like, somebody brought in, for the love of God, at some point. But we are in second place. So... Can't be too hard on everybody. But yes, it was nice to see the Arshakian unfrozen.
Quick shout out to Michael DeLu also, who had a pretty solid couple games.
He was better. He can't hit the net right now at all. he has to start scoring.
Yep.
We all thought I think at six or seven goals from him would be a good season for him to at least to make this team function.
Oh, no way, man. He had like 9 in his time here last year.
No, but that's what we talked about at the beginning of the season.
I fully expect double digits out of him. Otherwise, he's not worth the slot. Hmm. To me, he's not worth the slot unless he's 10-plus goal guy. And, you know, because he scored so many last year in his 18 games, something like that. That for me, like, he's got to deliver 10 goals. You get a lot invested in him in that sort of secondary striker role, and he needs to deliver. He has to start at least putting balls on fucking frame, like with actual good shots, because he's not even doing that. His passing is better. He was more involved these last two games, but anytime he gets a chance in front of the net, it's fucking Artur Alvarez time. Shank. Pushing the ball wide, not even putting it on frame. I mean, you know, when Solignac looks like a more confident finisher than you, things have gone deeply awry. Because poor Lucho in that offsides call, because that was a great finish from him. So I need to see more out of Michael Delo. I really do. He's the biggest key to this team's success in games the next 10 games. If he can get hot and score some goals the next 10 games, we're going to be in very, very good shape. Very good shape. The only other thing I wanted to touch on was how about the old boss G. Schweinsteiger trying to pass the ball to the wrong team in front of the net?
Oh, whoops.
It's a nice pass, though. Ah, it's nice to be able to laugh about these things. Alrighty. Well, we'll move on. Let's go right to the game preview. This Thursday, the big test comes to town. FC Dallas, easily the most threatening team in the league, shows up. A team that you should be terrified of. I am terrified of. Their last five. You know, they're not losing. Put it that way. They're doing what they got to do. They're winning and they're drawing. They're winning and they're drawing. So.
They did lose this weekend.
They did lose this weekend. I'm sorry. The current form doesn't have the loss there.
At home also. So.
Oh, all right. All right. Settle down, Nick. You see, you're all fired up.
I'm just telling you what.
Oh, happened. They lost. They lost to fucking San Jose.
Yeah. See, yep. That's why I'm all fired up.
Oh, the highlights are on Somos MLS right now. That's why I didn't get to this game. Wow. Wow. There are some things in the... some weaknesses here. Your boy, Jameer Haika, scored, Nick. No wonder why you're so fired up.
That's not my boy.
That's not your boy? I don't
know who he is. No. 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 I like that Lima kid from San Jose.
He's great. Like Jameer Haika's Albanian.
Yes.
I thought he was Finnish for a second there.
No, his name looks very Finnish. Yeah,
it does. It does.
Yeah, that's that does look Finnish. But
all right. So Dallas lost to San Jose at home and is now coming to Chicago. Are they ready to be beaten, Nick?
Well, I think that we might have a shot at this, okay? Now, follow along here, okay? So, like I said last week about Colorado, it's a midweek game. It's kind of conference, so, you know, East versus West. They don't really need this game. they would like to have it, of course, after losing at home. But on Sunday, they have a game at home against Houston, and that's their big game. So I wouldn't be surprised if they have a slightly weakened lineup on Thursday. Now, that said, their weakened lineup is still really, really good. But I think that with our strong form at home, with our pretty decent attack now, I'm not looking at this willing to surrender 3 points. I do think that we have a pretty good shot at getting something from this.
Fair. Rudy?
Agreed. I just don't see how they're going to try to put forth the strongest lineup against us when they have to concentrate on the West still. I mean, as Nick said, this team regardless is fucking good up or down, you know, up and down the whole roster. So there is no real weak team with Dallas. But with that said, yeah, I mean, it's something that favors us a little bit more, and our home form is good. The folks are ready to go. We found our lineup. We found what works. And with the midfield that we have, and that's what makes this thing roll, man, I don't know. I think we're going to get a point at least out of it. I honestly do believe that.
Confidence running high. Nothing like 3 wins in a row. I think Bosti sits this game, to be frank with you. He looked tired.
I want to agree with you, but I think he's a stubborn man, and I think he will. He'll tell Pano he's ready. He's good.
Yeah, whatever. Plus, if Juninho's ankle is fine, he's gonna go. He's gonna be on the bench.
Plus, you also have 9 points or nine days of rest. So it's not like, you know.
I know what you're saying. I'm not saying he's not gonna play. I'm saying he looked tired in that game, in the DC game. He looked tired. Now, that game was Friday. This game's Thursday. There's 6 days of rest. That game wasn't Friday.
It was Saturday.
It was Saturday. I was in here.
Early on Saturday. Early on Saturday.
Felt like Friday. you know, so I think you sit him and you bring him in late, and you just slot Juninho in and you play the basically, you know, most of the same lineup, but... You know, this is the game where guys are going to need, where we're going to need some, a little bit of lineup rotation. A little bit, not a ton. But, you know, Bossy's 32 years old, guys. I mean, come on, you know. He played 3 games on short rest, and he looked it in the third one. So, I'm okay with it. I mean, Juninho's right there. If Juninho's ankle wasn't bothering him, I think Juninho would have started against DC, because that seemed to be the game. And you'd want Schweinsteiger ready for Dallas. But, you know, whatever. It's unfortunate we don't actually have another striker, because I think Nico could use a break. But he clearly has to start. You don't have a choice there. And, yeah, otherwise I think I'm good where everywhere else. You know, Matt's gonna get the start. He's barely been back. Center backs are fine. I'm a little worried about Zhao's health. Zhao hurts himself every game. he is the man is everywhere, and he just takes an ass beating every game.
He's just gotta rub some of that Swedish cream. That's all. He'll be fine.
He cracks me up because half of the time it's because he's completely out of position and he just kills himself to make up for it, which is kind of amazing. I really love his effort. You know, also, to be honest, I think you, you know, maybe might want to mix it up a little bit on the wings if you can, but with 9 days of rest, you're probably not going to. Most of those guys are going to be fine.
Yeah. So. Yeah, this is kind of why I wanted to see some rotation for the Colorado game, so that we don't get to Dallas needing to sit guys. I know. So I would have had a full stronger lineup for this game than that one. But, I mean, if you can take the gamble and sit some guys for this one, I don't know. That's not a risk I'd be willing to take.
I mean, I suppose you could have a short hook for Schweinsteiger as long as Juninho's ready. I mean, a lot of this just depends on Juninho's health with the ankle injury. So,
yeah, do we have any news on that?
No.
Of course.
You never will. No, come on.
Yeah. I went looking. There is a press conference tomorrow. I'm sure news will come out Tuesday afternoon in regards to Juninho. So typically when we record, the news is not out for the week because that typically comes out on Tuesday. So look for it on Tuesday. I do think this is a potentially winnable game. I mean, Dallas is terrifying, but they are still a team, and this will be a good test of where we're at. I think some of the things we do well play well against a team like Dallas, who's very fast, and we pass the ball around, and they can tend to overcommit. And I think that will work to our advantage. Our lack of pace, though, will not. That's a problem against Dallas. We're slow. We're not very fast. We need to control the pace. We are at home, so hopefully we can control the pace of this game. But to be honest, you know, Christian Coleman did not start the game against San Jose. He almost assuredly will start against us. They probably will sit Rudy, who started this game. You know, and that's, I mean, you're not really losing much there between those two guys.
I would slightly disagree with that. I don't think Coleman's been very good this year.
I like Coleman a lot. I think his finishing has not been great so far this year, but yeah, he gets into dangerous spaces and he does dangerous things. And he's going to get going. He gets into good spots. He's terrifying. But he's not clicking yet, and he doesn't have to. The pressure's not on him to, because Rudy's there and this team is good, you know. He's got a chance to get worked in. I can see us having a chance in this game. I don't think this is the automatic loss that many of us put this down as to start the season.
Especially in the past.
Yeah. With that said, let's get to predictions, Rudy.
Oh man, I've been like teetering since we started this segment. I wanna my brain says tie, my heart says win. Oh man, you know what? I'm gonna go with my heart. 2-1 Fire.
Attaboy. Your goal scorers.
Nico, Poach. Basti, with some filth.
Okay. Nick.
Yeah. I'm going to go with the 1-1 draw. Goal from Lucho.
Classic Fedora. I'm also going with the classic Fedora 1-1 draw. I think we'll see. I'm just going to keep predicting him scoring goals till he fucking does. Michael Dula with the goal. That's how I show my faith in him. I'm going to show my faith in him. I'm backing my guy. He's not really my guy, but I'm backing him. 1-1. If we can get a draw against Dallas, even though you're conceding points at home, that's, to me, that's a... I'll take that. I'll take that this year.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
I'll take that any year.
The old Brimstone Cup, is that still on the line?
Yes, sir.
What's the status of that? What happens if there's a draw?
They retain. Right now, it is still being... It's a one game, or however many regular season games we play. That's the definition of it. In the future, if we happen to have a conference realignment or a third conference gets built, then the rules will change, more likely to reflect however many meetings we have, and in the future, hopefully include playoffs or some shit like that.
Oh, I love this. I love the term conference realignment.
I get there the tingles when I say it.
Delightful. Get us four conferences. Let's do this right. Okay. What is the status of the physical Brimstone Cup?
Bent as ever.
Bent? Okay. Yes. Okay. Just checking.
We have convinced the Dallas folks that the dent is character and character is needed. And it still riles up some of those Dallas folks who hate the dent. So we have to keep it.
Yeah, no, absolutely. The dent must stay.
A few years ago, I went down there when they retained. some lady was screeching at me. Why did you guys dent that cup? It just happened. Can I see the cup? I'm like, well, you're seeing it right now. I was going to hand it off to the team at that point just so they can hang around with it in the locker room. And she's like, it's a community cup. I can see it. I can grab it. And she tries to snatch it from me and I take it away. I'm like, no, you can see it, but you can't grab it. This is unfair. You can't do that. This is a family. This is a community cup. And she's just like cursing at me and all this. The cops come in. The cops come in and they're like, ma'am, you have to leave the premises. If you don't leave the premises, we will eject you and you will not be allowed in for the rest of the season. She went away screeching and cursing at me like you wouldn't believe. That dent did something.
The dent stays.
Yeah. The dent must stay.
My God, that's incredible. Well, we got one other thing to touch on. You know what that is.
Oh, yes. Oh, yes.
Liga MX Final. The Mighty Tigres. Cement Money. Versus Chivas. The Goats. Game one is Thursday. During after the Fire game. That's gonna be hard. Game two, Sunday night, 6:06 PM. If League MX Finals of the past are to go by, game one will end 0-0. So you gotta watch it because it's kind of like it's like the foreword to a good book chapter or a good book. It's a foreword to a good book.
It's priming you. It's priming you for the filth that is to come.
Yeah, because game two is the best game in the region every year. So, and there's two of them every year because League MX does it right and has two sets of playoffs and crowns two champions every season. I am surprised MLS hasn't been like, how can we have two MLS Cups a year? That'd be incredible. I love Mexico. It's a beautiful place. The Mighty Gignac looking for his back-to-back cups. Tuca, back-to-back. Chivas looking to prove their back once and for all. This is going to be great. I'm really excited about this. Rudy, I know you're on my side.
You have no fucking idea.
This podcast is firmly in the Cement Money clubhouse for this one. Nobody wants the goats. Nobody.
Goddamn right. Fuck the goats. Fuck them all day.
Fuck the goats. Real goats, fake goats. No one likes goats. It should be good stuff. Your, of course, finals are on Univision, family of networks. So, Unimas and the big U for the final. Or you can just turn on Univision Deportes. They will also have the game on. I was very happy to see Tigres knock out Xolos. I'm not going to lie. I was like, yep. Miguel Herrera, is he on his way to Club America? Has it happened yet? Is he on the plane?
He probably is on the plane as we speak.
How you feel about that, Rudy?
Bring him. Fuck the mustache.
La Volpe? Is
yes.
That what you guys call him? The mustache?
Yes.
I love La Volpe.
I hate him.
Yeah, no, no. I'm not sure I want him to coach one of my teams. I just love watching him coach. Got the cigarettes, the chest hair, the glasses.
He's toned down the cigarette. He keeps that for post games now. But yeah, that was what added character to him back in the day when he would just not give a fuck and just light up right on the bench, and the referees would be like no, and he'd be like, well, fuck you, I don't give a shit. And he would light up the cigarette. Yeah, he would legit tell him to fuck off and just keep smoking the cigarette.
Oh, Mexico. Oh, it's gonna be good. I'm really excited. I'm watching a preview for it right now. It's making me happy.
And
all right.
And you know that all the Chivas fanboys are just like, we're gonna do it, we're gonna do it. But they're gonna Cruz Azul the living shit out of this one. So they're just gonna find a way to fuck this up. And I am so excited. You know,
we can only hope they Cruz Azul it, because poor Cruz Azul could use somebody fucking up a final. They had a bad year.
They've had a bad
couple years. You know? No, I meant, but they were bad this year, dude.
Oh yeah, but still, they've had a bad like 18 years, if I remember correctly. So, you know,
they've gone to some finals in that time frame, though,
and they've royally fucked them up.
Yeah. But getting to a final is an achievement.
They had Moy Munoz score a goal on them in the 93rd minute.
I know. I watched that game.
That, you know, yeah.
That was incredible. That game was incredible. That was what, last year, right?
No.
Year and a half ago?
No, this is like 3 years ago.
Three, 4 years ago? Okay.
Yeah.
I get my Liga MX Finals mixed up in my head.
That one was one of the most epic finals ever. That was with El Piojo. That's when he became a meme. That's when they Dragon Balled.
God, Piojo. It's so many of these finals are so good, and they have chaos goals at the end, and it's incredible. I Liga MX defenses could be better. I'm not gonna lie, could be better. But there is something about that league where in the 86th minute, 87th minute it happens, many defenders, their brains, they just switch off. They're like, poof, there's like a switch built in, and like, nope, I don't play defense anymore.
It's like the skies darken, you know, the moon pops out, and things just get weird.
Yeah, this is really great.
One great way to put it, and we always say it and we always talk about it, but this would be the epitome of CONCACAF right here. It is like got the best of every aspect of it. Filth. Fan filth. Coach filth. I mean, referee filth. This is the perfect storm of everything.
It's the best league in the region for a reason. Like, it has the best teams, it has the best players, it has the best coaches. I love MLS, but it's not Liga MX. So I'm so sorry. It's just, you know, it's a great league. that's been around a long time and has great teams. You know, the fact that Tuca is just been like, just stays there, kind of boggles my mind.
Well, Tuca has basically got like that life contract that you expect from you know, from teams that have, that adore their coach, that brings mm-hmm. them such success that they're like, you know what? You can do whatever the hell you want. You can stay where as long as you want. The keys are yours. Just give them back when you're done, type of deal.
Yep.
He could have had that at the Luka, too. They loved him at the Luka. But, you know, shit happens, and the cement money comes a-calling.
The cement money comes a-calling. He's like, I can win a big one with this. A big one. And then now he's lost the CONCACAF Champions League 2 years in a row.
With the agony. Best team in the region ever.
Yeah. Yeah, probably. It's up there. It's up there with the Monterey teams.
But the Swazos won 1-1.
Yeah, they did. Yeah. Well, yeah, Chupete was... I mean, to me, Chupete was the best play, the best, one of the best strikers to play in the region.
Mm-hmm.
Before Gignac.
Yeah. He probably was the best signing ever in CONCACAF, I would say.
Hey, well, because he, for whatever reason, he had that, he went on loan to Spain, and he, then he, was good, and then, like, I don't know, he never went back? That's just the weirdest thing ever. But whatever.
Hey, yeah. The region benefited.
It really did. Really did. Well, and on that note, please watch the Liga MX Finals. It's great.
You will not regret it.
It will not be a 0-0 draw that goes to penalties. I fucking guarantee this.
It might go to penalties.
Yeah, but it's not gonna be the other team doesn't get a shot on goal and then wins the cup. That's not fucking going to happen.
Oh.
Sorry, both these teams are too good for that shit.
With that said, I hope Liga fucking demolishes them. Just like, it's like 5-0 after the first game.
You don't want that.
Yes, I do.
But you don't.
All the filth in the second game to preserve that 5-0 game. Gignac going in studs up on everybody. Oh, that would be... That's what we need.
Oh my god. I was heartened to see one of the Jolos players getting himself red carded on the last Jolos game. Just like fuck it. No. that's why he wasn't with us. Because he went to Mexico.
Just to get red card.
Yeah, just to get his red card on. Let's see. Who was it? Let me look. That game was Sunday. Let's see who got himself red carded. Guido Rodriguez, of course. God,
that name is amazing.
In the 49th minute, Guido Rodriguez eats the second yellow. Well, it looks like a straight red on the foot mob. He may have talked himself into a red card in classic Liga MX player fashion.
Wouldn't be right if it wasn't.
Yep. Good stuff. Good stuff. All right, everybody. You guys got anything else to talk about? I'm good.
I just want all the filth the next couple of days.
I'm sorry. We need to talk about the Red Stars.
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
My bad. My huge bad. The Red Stars beat the North Carolina Courage.
In North Carolina.
3-1 as Christian Press from the spot. She was great in this game, by the way. She's back. She was fantastic. Sofia Huerta.
Sofia.
Fucking golazo. Yeah, I know. I butchered her name slightly. My bad. I was waiting to get to the Huerta part.
Let's not butcher that name.
Sofia Huerta. And then Vanessa Di Bernardo also scored in the 45th, a nice goal. Although that had some shit defending on it that helped her along the way. Christian Press had an incredible dive in this game.
Oh, yeah.
It was beautiful.
Yeah.
It was beautiful.
It was a clear dive.
Nine out of ten on the Blanco scale. Was that good? This was a great game. Again, if you're not watching the Red Stars, it's incredibly easy to do so. They're either on Lifetime or the Go90 app.
Or at Toyota Park.
Or you go see them at Toyota Park.
Where you go every week anyway, so.
Yeah. It's easy. They're good. They're now third place in the table, 2 points behind the Courage. Sky Blue FC is tied with the Red Stars. The Red Stars have a good defense, but they haven't scored many goals, so it was good to see them get three. They badly need it, so.
Yeah, three goals on the road against the best team. That's a pretty good result.
I forgot, and that was the first game of the away home series versus the Courage, as they will be playing Saturday, May 27th. At Toyota Park, 3 p.m. against the Courage. So if they can win 3 points at home against the Courage and take 6 points, they can take first place. So, yep, all could be righted.
All right.
So good stuff. Support your Red Stars. All right, was there anything else?
I'm good.
Good, good, good.
Alrighty. Well, we should be back on regular schedule. So, we apologize for the snafu. I was really excited to listen to Rudy's guest hosting that he did. And then we had a recording issue. Unfortunate. But don't worry, Rudy will get the stick. He'll be in the lead chair sooner than later.
Way to make it sound ominous and shit.
No, it's not ominous. It's good. I'm happy about it. I can just take a siesta occasionally on Mondays. It's nice.
Let's do it.
Yep. Alrighty. Show's done. Rudy.
Fuck Dallas.
For Nicholas.
Fuck Phelps.
Jesus. Unsurprisingly, Sarah did not make the show. So, goodbye for Sarah, and I'm Gregg. We'll talk to you next week. Goodbye!
We mess with Texas.
Things I learned about Nick this show. Does not like belts.
Nah, I don't like belts. In like the last like 7-8 years, like I've tried to wear belts like a couple times, and like each time it's like, why? This is pretty useless, so fuck it.
You're a very skinny man, though. Some of us need belts, Nick.
But like I find pants that, you know, fit me.
Nick. Some of us need belts.
It's fine. It's
no matter what.
I think that like belts look good and that you should wear one fine, but I just don't. So
I want to see you with a giant belt buckle on someday.